falling tide. And then we could see in the moonlight this head come up behind a rock outcropping, and these two big shoulders. And to me, it looked like a width of a 45-gallon drum and a half. And that's when I was like, holy shit, that thing's big. And then it went into the bush, and the boat was parallel to the western beach. And we were closest to that beach than anything. Like, we were maybe 40, 50 yards off. And then that, you could hear it going through the bush really quietly. And that's what really spooked me, was something so bloody big could walk through the bush so bloody quiet. And I was standing with the galley door open, and in front of me on the side of the boat on the port side was Dean hanging on to the side rigging going up to the mast and boom. And then all of a sudden, we're both like, you could see Dean flinch and look, it's like he's squinting, he's looking, and I'm looking too. And you could see this shadow come out of the bush right beside the boat, and it was crouched down, like its body low, like someone creeping under a window of someone's house. And it was creeping down, and Dean just went, holy shit, what is that? And that thing stood up, and I always remember seeing the long hairs hanging off that left arm when it swung and stood up, and you hear this big, whoa, and that thing just stood up and just took these big, massive strides. And I'm sitting there, got more behind Dean and more behind the galley door, because I thought, these things are supposed to throw rocks and driftwood. And that bloody thing can't be more than 60 yards away from us. It throws anything, it's going to hit the side rigging, Dean, or the galley door, and I'm getting in there and getting my 12-gauge. And then that thing walked into the bush. We swung the spotlight, see a little bit of it, and you could hear it. Now it knows the jig's up. It doesn't want to be in stealth mode. You could just hear it going through the slough bushes, which is looks like a tea type of plant, and it's like super steel wool thick in the forest. Pretty impossible to walk through slough and not make noise. Well, this thing sounded like a D8 cat going through there at 20 miles an hour. Then all of a sudden it got quiet, and it whistled a deep, low-pitched whistle chirp. And then further back in the hill, you heard a high-pitched whistle chirp, and then the male continued on through the slough, and that was it. It was over an hour and a half.
Have you ever seen one disappear right in front of your eyes?
No, it's a bunch of bullshit.
Yeah, okay. I just wanted to ask you that, because...
He came back to protect the female.
No, he sent the female back in the bush, and he came and reconned us. Yeah, because at one point we actually heard him sniffing us. These big, deep, drawn in sniffs, like it was breathing us. You know, then that's what you do in the bush. It's, you know, you use your nose over your eyes and your ears in most cases, and your eyes. And you usually smell something before you're going to hear it, see it.
Could you see breasts on the female? How did you know it was a female? And was there genitalia?
No, we just say it was a female because it was like smaller in its hips, meager, and shoulders and everything.
Igor, take those things down to the basement.
Yes, master. I'm sorry.
Igor? Igor's here. Tom, Igor's here.
I'm sorry. I let the creatures out of the dungeon.
Igor, it sounds like Cheech and Chong's Uncle Pervy.
Yes,
Igor, go eat some barnacles, Igor.
I'm going to take these creatures with me into the dungeon.
All right. Does anyone else have any questions about the experience that he had? Jeff, Adam?
I do have a question about, I guess, the way they reproduce. Do they reproduce the same as humans? Do they carry for 9 months? Do they often reproduce? Do you know anything about that?
No.
You don't know anything about that?
I can imagine, but no, I don't know anything. I've never seen it.
Have you ever seen them mating?
No.
No jackhammer.
seen sea kayakers mating, no?
Right on.
Wow. That sounds like a good story.
Have you ever seen any...
Yeah, she was hairier than a Sasquatch.
Have you ever seen kayaked along the coast to look for Bigfoot?
Who, me? I'm a big fat Indian, man. You can't get my fat ass in a kayak. But I do run a kayak company. Me and my wife have a tour operation called Hamumu Adventures. Just think of Happy Cow Cow, H-A-M-O-O-M-O-O Adventures. We do sea kayaking expeditions. I've been doing it I've been involved with the sea kayaking industry since its inception in the mid-80s on coastal British Columbia. Worked with them for numerous years. I had my own three companies that I've run.
Can we bring our guns if we come with you? We like guns.
Canadian citizen, you got FAPC, by all means bring a gun.
All right, let's shoot some shit out there, man. Come on, let's go shoot some shit, man. Come on.
Except we'll get one thing straight, though. Now that I'm a little bit older and I got gray hair, I respect my Kwakwaka'wakw culture and heritage and laws, and we are never to harm or disrespect or hurt the big fellas and their families.
Oh,
y'all show them respect. And that's one of the reasons why I'm pretty anti-woo-woo. And especially after I was on a podcast there in the beginning of February with Keegan Reed there and Understanding Sasquatch. He's got out, he should call his YouTube show Misunderstanding Sasquatch, because I gave them the benefit of the doubt. Number one, I went on a show, I knew they wanted to talk woo-woo, you know, all about the mind speaking, going into orbs and different portals and turning into orbs. I thought, right. You know, okay, yeah, I'll go on there. Maybe I can convert some of those woo-woos to see the light and, you know, actually not in the orb either, and come over to the right side where this thing is just a living, breathing creature. But the First Nations, and, you know, I've found it's pretty much indicative to all of them that I've spoken to across my travels and my life through Turtle Island that, yeah, you show them respect. They're just another tribe that we share our homelands with, and you don't disrespect them. And I find the woo-woos that it's very disrespectful what they're doing.
You watch them for an hour and a half. You know that they're an animal. Is that what you're saying?
Well, I've seen them a couple other times, too. You know, I've lived in Bush for almost 3 years.
Hold on. So, okay. Wolfman, do you want to get into that, or do you want to talk about what he's got going on for tours and stuff?
Well, I believe it's time for some rock and roll, man. And I've been dying to do this after talking with Jim Marlin. And he mentioned this band, which he has a mysterious connection with this band, Wishbone Ash. So I'm going to play a Wishbone Ash song, man. Pretty groovy, eh? I don't know.
Yep. They're like Thin Lizzy.
Persephone. We'll be right back.
is the Monster Castle Paranormal Radio Show. We explore the paranormal phenomenon with researchers and skeptics from all walks of life and beyond. Fridays and Saturdays, 9 p.m. Pacific, midnight Eastern, on KTLK, Digital Broadcasting Network, TheFringe.fm. Visit our website at MonsterCastleParanormal.com.
And we are back, ladies and gentlemen, with Mr. Tom Sweet. How do I pronounce your last name?
Seawid, like squid.
Seawid.
Seawid.
Seawid. Yeah, cool, man. That's very, very unique. I love it. Yeah.
It's paddling towards the chief, giving potlatch.
Oh, and that potlatch, is that kind of like something that you smoke or what? I don't know. I have no idea.
It's our celebration of life. It's where we go and show all our dances, enter our family members into the societies they're aspired to or born into, you know, chieftains, Hamatsa Society, Swan Society for women. They're like our noble woman leaders.
I would love to go to a powwow one time. My buddy plays bass for me. He's native. I keep bugging him to take me. I want to
potlatch. It's like, you know, you live in Canada, you know. You have to get out to the coast and check it out. You know, you look at, like, I have a Facebook group I stupidly went and checked on back in November last year. It was a friend of mine started it called Sasquatch Island. And it's, you know, it's sort of coining on Vancouver Island because it has so many Sasquatch and Bigfoot sightings there. So I went and checked out his site, and lo and behold, there's my post from months before, and it says 42 members in this group. And I thought, wow, this is stagnant. And then I noticed a little thing up in the tabs there. It said, this group needs an administrator. And I went and clicked it and started putting my 2 cents worth in. And all of a sudden, lo and behold, it started getting popular. People really liked my First Nations native perspective and Bushman perspective to Sasquatch Bigfoot. And, you know, I think we're, by the end of the weekend, I should crack 1,700 members. I know it's not much, but I post on about 20 other Sasquatch Bigfoot related groups throughout Facebook daily if I can.
I got a question from the chat room. A-hole Skeptic says he'd like to know more about Bigfoot boobs and the naughty bits.
Hairy nipples. No, I'm just kidding. Bigfoot boobs.
Hashtag 47 talk. That's our Twitter chat room.
There you go. Now he's going to play.
Yeah, females.
Now we're going to get that gentleman out to the West Coast. He's going to have to come chase his fetish there, Bigfoot boobs, because Vancouver Island is the highest concentration of Sasquatch carvings on Earth. So when you get to Vancouver, even, it has a pretty phenomenal level of West Coast native Sasquatch carvings throughout. Most people don't know because they see this slit-eyed with lips puckered up and big ears with these big pendulous breasts and, you know, even shows nipples.
Holy hairy nipple.
And it's carved on totem poles, and it's in native gift galleries. It's even in the Vancouver International Airport. And when they get to Vancouver Island, they see this naked woman with these large pendulous breasts, her lips puckered up, and her slit eyes. Well, what that is the Kwakwaka'wakw interpretation of a nocturnal bipedal creature our ancestors have lived with and come across, and were so mesmerized and enthralled by what they saw, and not on a sexual context, but on seeing this giant bipedal hair-covered female creature, that because it has slit eyes, it's nocturnal. They see it in the daytime. That's when humans are out and about, and it's yawning, and that's how they dance on some of the families on the big house floors. And the puckered up lips are because you hear the Chunahua hollering from island to island. Whoop, whoop, whoop. And that's the noise she makes and the male makes. And, of course, you know, the large breasts and everything, you know, maybe it's indicative of Mother Earth. Who knows? I can't say. It's up to our ancestors, and they're long gone now. But Vancouver Island is covered in these totem poles and these masks of the Chunahua. And when you go to the museums on Vancouver Island, starting in Victoria, at the Royal British Columbia Museum and downtown. It has a ceremonial, traditional-styled big house with a big sea monster painted on the front, right in downtown Victoria where all the tour buses go by. And outside of it is a totem pole with a female Junocha holding a baby one in her arms on that totem pole. And when you go into that museum, you see a cave. And then you look into that cave, you're going to see masks from the Kwakwaka'wakw people from Guilford Island, from the Kwakwaka'wakw tribe of the Kwakwaka'wakw, my bloodlines. And you'll see a Sasquatch mask inside that cave. And if you journey to Guilford Island, you can listen to the native people if they want to share with you the story of the Animal Kingdom cave and how there's a Sasquatch in that ancient legend that belongs to many families. And every native art gallery in Western Canada will have the Junocha masks, rings, small totem poles, paintings, t-shirts, the list goes on. You journey north of Victoria, you come in over the Malahat Mountain on the highway, you come into a small city called Duncan, the Coast Salish part of Vancouver Island, different tribe than mine, different people. But Duncan is just covered in totem poles, and you'll see three Kwakwaka'wakw-styled poles throughout the city, and two of them have Chonacha, Wild Woman of the Woods. You go to their cultural center that's now closed, but you can still go on the property. You'll see the Coast Salish interpretation of the Wild Woman of the Woods, their female Sasquatch. You get the Campbell River, central eastern side of Vancouver Island. You go behind Superstore and you see the First Nations whose territory that area is, and their graveyard for their past loved ones. You will see poles, memorial poles, and you'll see one beautiful one with the Junocha carved in it. And if you drive through Campbell River, it's got the highest concentration of Sasquatch carvings for any community in the world. And you'll see ones done by native artists, non-native artists,
hey,
chainsaw
Tom?
Carvers.
Hey, Tom, can you tell us about some of the television shows that you have been in and what you're working on now?
I used to be the host of a travel television show called Aboriginal Adventures Canada for 3 seasons. But back in, going back to when I had that sighting on the boat, when I went to John Bindernagel and told him my sighting report, he came out, got a hold of me and said, hey, I got these guys want to do a Sasquatch show. So I did a first one was called X Creatures or X Monsters from done by BBC from England. But a bunch of sappy colonialists, those pompous asses were. But anyway, I did the show and about Village Island sighting I had. And then I did a couple more shows through the years. I can't remember which ones now. But if someone gets a hold of me through Thomas Seawood on Facebook or through Sasquatch Island on Facebook or through the website Hamumu Adventures and talks to me and gives me an email page I use for when I'm talking to different people about what I do and things. I have all those shows I've gathered up through the years on YouTube, and I have them on a Word doc that I can email you, and you can sit there for about an hour and a half and watch different shows I've done. A lot of them I'm dressed up in West Coast Native attire, sharing legends and stories that belong to my family and experiences I've had.
That's awesome. Hey, Jeff or Adam or Miss Oracle, do you have any questions for him? You guys there?
Yep.
Okay. Adam, do you got anything? You guys are pretty quiet over there.
Yeah.
I'm starting to wonder what you're doing over there.
Said barnacle too much. They're half corked.
Yeah. I'm just listening. It's very interesting.
Do you think... do you think that the Bigfoots track the stars ancient man used to do?
Yes. The reason why I say that is I think I give them the benefit of the doubt that they're more human than a lot of people will believe or even accept. And if being on the out on the coast for so long, like I've lived the bushman's existence, you know, from float houses to tents, structures on the beaches to fish boats or whatever, watching logging camps in the wintertime, living on a big boat and being a hunting guide for bears, grizzly bears and blacks. I was out in bush, and when I started my eco watchman's program, and then it evolved into an eco-cultural tourism, sea kayaking, bear watching, whale watching, sports fishing, native cultural tour operation, I didn't have television. And when the wind came up and it was a sunny day and wasn't raining, you get bored. So what do? You go gunk hole about. You go poking around, looking, you know, just interacting with your environment. And I remember times doing that, and I'd go see these ancient rock carvings called petroglyphs, and, you know, trying to figure out what my ancestors were carving into stone. And, you know, one time I remember putting a sheet down and rubbing it with a piece of burnt wood from a fire, charcoal, and I got the image. And when I brought it, took a picture of it and showed one of my elders, who's my advisor still to this day, and I was asking him, what are these creatures? And he shared me the story, and it was part of the Atlagum, the forest world. And he was giving me his family's version, equivalent to the carvings I'd seen. And then I said, what are these? And he goes, those are, what do you call those things up in the sky at nighttime? I said, stars? He goes, no, the groups of stars. I said, constellations, I think they're called. He goes, yeah, that's what those are. He goes, if you go to this place in my homeland, and you look at the rock carvings and you see those round circles, they're like divots, little concave depressions. And if you look at that shape of that constellation and you look up into the sky at that certain time of the year when that constellation's up there, that's when the ooligans are going to return, a small fish that goes into glacier-fed rivers to spawn that our people harvest to this day. And we make an oil out of the fish called Kleetna, ooligan oil. It's equivalent to our ketchup or spice. It's really good. And we also smoke the ooligans, and they're called candlefish because they're so high in oil. You can light up a smoked dry ooligan, and it'll burn for quite some time because of the oil.
And I want to eat one live on the air.
Yeah. are they like smelt, Tom?
Yeah, pretty much. I think they're actually in the same genus or something. Okay. And they're pretty cool. They're good eating.
Oh, I bet. Yeah. Do you smoke them?
Yeah, we smoke them. They're like a herring kipper, but more smokier and more richer.
Come on, open your ears. Come on, open your ears.
Sorry.
You just said that.
That's what we used to do with the smell.
There's another place that if you go look at the rock carvings and the constellation chipped into the rocks, if you look up at a certain time of the year, it'll correlate to right now. And that constellation's above Quadra Island, southeast corner. And that's when the herring return to that area to spawn. And another one has moons carved into it, the seventh moon being July, which means the salmon will return. And lo and behold, there's a fisherman with these seven moons and a fish carved into the rock. So when you asked about, do you think Sasquatch uses the stars? Well, you can take salmon that are returning to coastal British Columbia and to the rivers where they were born in to spawn, and you bring them to a planetarium like the scientists did, and you put them in that that big tank in the middle of the planetarium, and you turn out the lights, and you put the stars and the constellations that are indicative of that day of and time of the year. And then all of a sudden, with the magic of this planetarium's projector, you turn the stars, the fish will actually turn. So a fish can use celestial navigation and celestial calendars. And if birds do it as well, from what I've read in National Geographic and other animals, then, and humans have done it for thousands of years. That's how the Polynesians got to the Americas long before Christopher Columbus ever did, or the Vikings. And the Chinese, they were here before Christopher Columbus as well. How did they get here? Celestial navigation. And it's just that we've been colonialized to believe that it was the Spanish and the Portuguese and the British that taught us celestial navigation. No, we've known about celestial calendars and navigations for tens of thousands of years. And for benefit of the doubt with the Sasquatch Bigfoot, I would imagine they look up into the heavens at night and figure out where they're going to go next.
That was the question of the night.
Yeah.
The answer of the night.
That's pretty cool. Yeah, it was great, man. Okay. We'll get some cheers for that, yeah, for sure. Hey, I was gonna ask too, No, I don't remember. I lost it.
I have a few.
Yeah, it'll come back to me.
Really?
No.
Well, I've got one from APOC in the chat room. He's wondering if they're more like gorillas or do you think they're more human? And I would imagine you would think they're more human. But
it's,
I don't know.
It's a tough one, you know, for me being out in the bush and hearing them, seeing them three times, hearing the stories, researching the encounters, listening to the First Nations interpretations of it and seeing it being enacted in potlatch dances, it's really tough. You know, there's so many things that they do that's primate equivalent, like throwing sticks, shaking foliage, pushing rotten trees down on you, throwing rocks, expelling a stench that, you know, gags you. And
like farts.
Then again, they have so much human characteristics. And, you know, two of the reports that I've received is that have just, actually three of them that have really just floored me was one recently where I was on another, actually it was the person who first got me into this podcasting. He invited me on a show. And anyway, he had such a great following and people liked me for the first show that he invited me back right away for two others within the same week. And we ended up doing five or six podcasts with him in over a 2-week period. But on the third one, I released my, I guess they call it a thesis or a theory. And it's based upon my research and just what I know that I looked at Sasquatches and I see that when you read the reports of Lewis and Clark coming across the United States, Alexander Mackenzie and others coming across Canada, the first explorers, the first newspapers that started in Missouri and places like that, you had a high incident amount of reports of these mountain devils, bush devils, hairy humans, things they called
really?
Them. And then all of a sudden, there's really nothing. It's, you don't hear about the Indians through the 1800s and to the mid early 1800s to the early 1900s. You really don't hear about the Indians other than a few massacres like, you know, what Custer tried to do and others did with Wounded Knee and that and Lewis and Clark, not Lewis and Clark, with Louis Riel in Canada. You hear about those things, but the Indians as a whole were sort of, they weren't mentioned really. And the reason for that is because of almost 100 million or more Indians, smallpox, influenza, tuberculosis, and venereal disease decimated our numbers throughout Turtle Island and Central and South America by some 98%.
I know. We've talked about that on our show a lot.
Yeah, and when Vancouver and others came to British Columbia, they talked about coming to these rotting houses with totem pole villages that were abandoned except for the skulls and the pelvic bones and the spinal bones strewn all about, bleached in the sun. And the few Indians they did find were living an existence where they just lived through an apocalypse.
They sure did.
Pandemic of the indigenous peoples that is unprecedented in human history. And
I agree.
So now when I got a report about a northern tribe, and out of respect, I've told the person I wouldn't name the native tribe, but when they were going through their smallpox epidemic, their ancestors reported them dying in their village and in their big houses with sick people and bodies all over. And all of a sudden, this family of Sasquatches showed up at the edge of their village, almost like gesturing and pleading. And when they went to see them, their entire tribe, too, was infested with smallpox, and some were being held on the verge of death. And so when I heard that, it just went snap. That's why there's no reports of Sasquatch throughout Turtle Island through the mid-1800s until about the mid-1900s, when all of a sudden Roger Patterson and Bob Gimlin, lo and behold, captured it on this film camera. And then we're seeing since 1960, whenever that Roger Patterson Gimlin film was taken, to present day, especially in the last 25 years, we're seeing a great increase in the sightings of Sasquatch Bigfoot. Why is that? Well, if you come to Vancouver or anywhere throughout British Columbia or Canada, that go to Manitoba, for God's sakes. What do you notice? Us Indians are coming back like rabbits. And you go down to the United States, and there's 268 tribes with casinos, and their villages are filled with Indians. We're coming back. We're immunized now. We've survived the epidemics. The apocalypse that hit us with contact is over, and now we're starting to proliferate in our numbers, and we're seeing the same parallel coming on with Sasquatches. And that's why I'm a firm believer that within the next couple of years we will have that conclusive proof of their existence.
And we are again at the bottom of the hour. Time to take a short break, everyone. And we'll return shortly with this interesting discussion. And Oracle is here too. So, and we will be taking your calls. So I don't know if you're up to it, Oracle. If you're willing to take readings from calling.
Yeah. I'll try my best. Yes.
Okay. So we do have a psychic here. Any question you want is valid tonight. So we'll be back shortly, and I hope we get some callers. This could be fun. Absolutely.
From the fourth dimension. Did I forget to mention a thing? She could sing with a fifth dimensional ring in a voice that'll sound like angels coming from the sky. She could sing. She could sing. She was a groovy little baby with a fifth dimensional ring in a voice. That's right, all right, dig it, yeah. From the Wolfman, sing it out now, yeah. Here we go. Groovy little baby from the fourth dimension. Did I forget to mention one thing? She could sing. Groovy little baby with a fifth dimensional ring in a voice that is. She could sing like an angel coming from the sky. She could sing. Groovy baby with a fifth dimensional ring.
You're here with Dave Cruz and Wolfman Mike, and please listen to our new network,
KTLKDB, thefringe.fm.
All right. Everybody come on out and listen, and we're going to have a lot of fun now because we all join in forces. All right. And this is going to be where the disclosure comes from. Yeah. It's where all the freaks hang out. Yeah, we're back. It was just a short one. We're going to continue. Where were we left off with Tom?
Okay.
See what? I still having trouble.
Seawood.
Seaweed.
Right?
Oh, he's not back yet. Okay, no worries. Let's see what we're going to do here. What do you think about what I want to mention is that I didn't have a guest for tonight. My guest canceled, and this guy, he jumped in last minute. I asked him if he would mind my guest canceling, and he was very, very gracious to offer his time. Canceled his plans and went.
Canceled his trip.
Yeah, he canceled his trip tomorrow for us to do this show, so we got to appreciate it, everyone. Yeah, it's pretty awesome. Yeah.
Tom, you back?
Autumn, what's been happening with you?
Oh, I think he said his microphone wasn't working.
That's Jeff.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's Tom.
Yeah.
Autumn, how are you doing?
Yeah, I just asked her.
You're on live radio.
I'm good.
Okay, I'm getting back on.
I've had a long week, so I was enjoying listening to people's story and relaxing.
Okay.
Sure.
I'm back
on. I've got more questions for Tom.
I know you do. Let him out. Let him out of his cage, Igor.
All right.
You guys will have me back.
All right.
All right. I'll come up with more questions next time. Why do you think that the Bigfoot covers their face? The male.
Well, with the Bequest, the spiritual one, I don't think it wants to be seen by the humans, because according to our stories, it's the Bakwas, the little skeletal creature that has hair on it, and it's moves like a bird, they say. If anyone's interested about it, you can go to our cultural center's website, umitsta.com or .org. Or .ca, but it's UMISTA, umitsta.ca. And you can read about the Bakwas and Junaha and other things in our culture, but it's shy. It's the right. Keeper of the ghost world. So when you drowned, your soul is owned by the Bakwas in the ghost realm. And they say if you get lost in the forest and you get scared, afraid, cold, fear just takes over you, you know, like the woo-woos, and all of a sudden you're running and thrashing through branches, tripping over things, and you're panting, sweating, you're cold now, and you find a overhang rock or under a big tree and you go to sleep. When you wake up, they say there might be a piece of bark laid out like a platter, and upon it are smoked ooligans and herring eggs, smoked fish, halibut, salmon berries, and you start eating it. Well, as you're eating it, you notice that beautiful, delectable foods has now turned into worms, maggots, snakes, slugs, and you're spitting it out, but it's too late. You've given in to your fear and temptation, and you've eaten the ghost food of Bakwas, and now your soul's captured by him, and you jump up and you run like hell down the mountain trying to get back to your warmth of your family's fires, where your love and security has always been, and food and warmth and blankets and family members. And all of a sudden you part the wall of the forest and you look down off the mountain and you see the smoke from your family's fires in their houses, and you run and run and run downhill, and you stop and you look again to see how close you've gotten, and all of a sudden you've realized that you're further than where you last looked. And that's what keeps happening. Because you gave in to temptation and you've eaten that ghost food, your soul is captured by the bliss. And as hard as you try, you can't get back to the security, the warmth, the love of your family, your home. Well, my second cousin did a television show, and he's a famous carver from Alert Bay, and he's the one who came up with that. And he was saying exactly what I'm saying. It's his story, his version. And he said the Bakwas is the modern day equivalent to temptation. So if you become addicted to a substance, especially, God forbid, if you become an alcoholic or a drug addict, think about it. You've given in to temptation. You've sampled the goods of the modern day Bakwas, the drug dealer, the alcohol. And if you succumb to it, you're captured by it. And all of a sudden, and we know the stories of people stealing from their family members to support their addictions, and all of a sudden they're cast out of the family home and their locks are changed. And you can imagine what it's like for a drug addict or a stark raving alcoholic to walk by their home that they used to live in and look at it and know that the locks are changed and they can't knock on the door because their parents, their family, their wife, their husband is going to tell them, I'm sorry, as much as I love you, I can't have you in this home, leave. So there's an analogy of a creature that's out here in coastal British Columbia that is even found throughout all of the world to this modern day. And yet it's a quack, walkie, walk story that encompasses addiction. And it's related to a hair-covered, small, bipedal creature that is from the spiritual world. And, you know, when my cousin said that, it just floored me, you know, and it's actually really helped me in my life. You know, I drink wine, I like beer, I like the odd scotch. You know, I've only heavy duty addiction I do have is chewing my nails and smoking tobacco and drinking coffee. Everything else I keep guarded, and I will not be that stark raving drunk Indian. It's just not my thing. And that's because of my cousin on television years ago that was able to do our way of Noosa to tell a story. And he shared that story on television, but he shared it with me, and his words have kept me on the straight and narrow. I've never had an impaired charge.